grade, and that seemed to be a good idea. I applaud the people who have spoken tonight. I think both for the young and I think more so perhaps for the older individuals. It takes a lot of courage to get up in front of a group like this knowing that you are clearly in the minority. The kids in the school department, I give great applause and credit. I think you've worked very, very hard. I think you are here because you're concerned. I am here because I'm concerned. I don't think anyone is here tonight because they are not concerned about the Cape Elizabeth School Department. I also know that we have decimated the fire chief's budget. We've put off a new fire engine. We've put a lot of things on hold, capital budget-wise, because of our feeling that we just simply had to get the numbers down. Not that there's a magic to any of the numbers, not that 7 is better than 6 or 5 is better than 4. And I'm not even sure what 9.9 versus 10.8, I mean, it translates into $73,500. I'm not sure what that means in terms of numbers other than a desire to try to look at everyone in Cape Elizabeth and not at all take away from the school, knowing how important the school is for all of us who live here. Yarmouth, 10.6%, South Portland, 10.9%, Scarborough, 10.7%. They're all high this year, were high this year. I'd only end by saying, you know, rumor has it that Cape Elizabeth has some very wealthy individuals. If there's anyone around tonight that can write a check for $73,500, we certainly don't want to avoid a very practical solution to our dilemma. But pending that not happening, I too cannot vote in my conscience tonight for a 10.8 overall increase. And I very much hope that in working on this bench with my fellow counselors, we can figure out some way to arrive at a 9.9% increase.
Thank you. Council Masterson.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. This is a very difficult decision to make. It's probably the most difficult decision that I've had to make, other than sewer matters, since I've been on this board. I have listened with great interest and great respect to all of you who have spoken tonight. I listened to you, Frank. Where are you? Frank Potenzo. I've listened to the other retired people, or soon to be retired people, and I'm getting there myself. I certainly am on a fixed income, and I know what that means. At the same time, I've listened to those of you who have children in the schools. I understand your strong support for your school system. And Sally, even though you don't have a child in school yet, I really applaud your action that you've taken on this issue. And I wish you good luck with your kids in the Cape school system. But I think the one that has swayed me the most tonight is Hal Pages. Where are you, Hal? Is he gone? There he is. I think Hal's right on when he says that in local government, maintaining your school system is the focal point. Sorry, police and fire. But in this town, particularly, the maintenance of our schools and the maintenance of excellence has always been a strong focus in this town. Now, we asked the school board to go back and make a cut of well over $200,000. They came back to us with a cut of approximately $90,000. They told us, and I trust them, at that time, that to make any more cuts would cut deeply into program. And as it is, they have cut some into program, as you all know, or your parents know. It may be that we wear our white gloves, but we are civilized people, and we do try to carry on a one-town concept, that we're not divided on the municipal side versus the school side. We've been trying to carry out that idea, and I see no reason for my not wanting to continue that concept. I am troubled about the increase. I am troubled about the great cost of the career ladder, yet I support the concept. So you see, this is not an easy decision. I am also troubled by the fact that on the municipal side, our employees are receiving a 5% increase. That isn't quite fair. But tonight, I'm going to go along with this motion. And I hope you'll forgive me if it's the wrong motion for you.
Anybody else? You're not speaking? Something's wrong if you're not going to say that. I'll say that. Council McCall.
Previous noise from the microphone hit me in. I think a lot of words have been said tonight, and I appreciate all that has been said. I think my fellow councilors have put forth some feelings that I don't want to reiterate to you. I go along with a lot of what they have said. I go along with what a lot of you from the audience have said. I did have one phone call yesterday afternoon and concluded my conversation with that person by saying, yes, this is what I'm doing for Mother's Day. I am sitting here and agonizing over the town budget. And it really can be agonizing. I see Loretta shaking her head. Yeah. It's been a tough, tough year for the budget. And one thing that I'm really keeping in mind is how tough it's going to be again next year. One thing that kept coming to mind yesterday was the cumulative impact of what we are going to be doing this year and how it's going to affect us next year. And I really want us all to keep that in mind. Some of the rough figures I looked at, and I'm only looking at a couple of things, have us already at a scary place next year, because we've got our school department starting at $350,000 in the hole because of some of their actions to keep down the budget for fiscal year 91. That's going to be very difficult to make up. That comes to, if all the numbers are the same as this year, that's close to 60 cents on the taxes for next year, right there. It's painful, it's very painful. And I don't know what else I can say about it. It's really a difficult decision. And I'm still thinking.
Thank you. Councilor Cogshaw.
I just wanted to sort of support a suggestion that was made by Sally Martin on the idea of being able to maintain certain programs, perhaps with user fees. When I lived in New York State, they have what was called a school tax, which was an additional tax paid by those families who had children in the school systems. And at this point, the legislature does not allow us to set up any new local taxes. But perhaps this is the way we're going to have to help relieve the pressure on the property tax, is to have perhaps a second or separate school tax. This is a concept I think that should be explored by all.
Thank you. I just want to make a couple of comments, and then maybe we get into the nitty gritty here, so all your people go home and then we wind up the agenda. I appreciate everybody coming tonight. I really enjoyed myself. Trying to keep it all straight and behave. And I give myself a star for that if a teacher out there's got an excellent. But I am concerned about the budget. I'm concerned about the double-digit increase, 10.8%. And I'm concerned about, and I just want to put the school board on record, that sat right here in front of me, and I spoke to someone before. I don't want them to get mad at me, because I may get a touchy point, that you go, as I said before, start after that last meeting and review your next year's budget and see if there isn't some way that you can come up with some reductions. And because I feel that they all, the rest kind of went around it, but I'm going to get to the point, is 7 and a 5% in a one-town concept isn't good business, in my opinion. And we tried to hold the budget down. And I asked for a list of all the people that work in the school system. And I still think that you're awful heavy on your administration. Now, I could be wrong, but if I may, and you don't mind, if I read a couple, three of them, put my glasses on, smile a little. You have, now everyone tells me these are very important. You gotta have them. Career ladder director, special ed director, curriculum director. Then you have all these other little directors down in the system that reports to these up here. I feel and talk to other people in other systems. There's other people that could do some of that work that you already have employed and that you need employed. You get down at the Pond Cove School, principal, assistant principal, administrative assistant, secretary K through three, secretary K through three, secretary K through five, secretary guidance, 4 to 8. Then you go on and on. I'm in favor of the teachers. I have no qualms for the teachers, no qualms with, I call it, Harold Pace's career ladder. I just have a qualm with the steps that they jump up, because I think they jump too fast at one time, and I wish you people would take a look at it. Now, in the elementary school, I added them up. Now, I know some of them only worked part of the day, but these are numbers that I was given to me. 40 teachers, K through 5. 41 other people involved. Specialists, special ed teachers, special ed assistants, special therapists. I could go on and read them all. You get up to the 6th, 7th, and 8th. Oh, excuse me, I left something. No, that's right. 6, 7, and 8, you got 16 teachers there. But you got 31 other people doing jobs within the system of special people. Now, I know there's 8 or 9 of them that work from K to 8, 4 to 8, excuse me. And some of them only work the 6th and 8th. And I think I had it down here as 9 people that worked that way, were double. There was a phys ed people that worked that way. And this is where I say, I'm not ready to cut no programs. I put the shop and the home ec, because I think people should be able to cook. They should be able to drive a nail, know what kind of a saw they should have when they want to do something. And I think that's a very, very important part of a school program. Fought them for years. They're always taking them out, putting them back, taking them out, putting them back. And I've been around here as long as Harold Pace has had. Maybe a couple of years longer. I don't know. But this is what I feel that you people should do and see if something can be done now. They tell me they can't do anything this year. After our last meeting, they found a place where they cut $20,000. Somebody, and that was because they was going to pay the town employees bi-weekly. But somebody come up with a law that has been on the books. They can't do that. So they got to put that person back into the system around $16,000. So they gained $4,000 out of the deal, as far as cutting their budget in it. Now, I'm ready to get to the point. Do you people, school board, feel that you can go back into your budget and come up with any bucks without affecting the educational programs of the town? Please.
working on this budget 3 months. We've spent approximately 60 hours in budget meetings. That may be answered to your question, Sally, when you ask if there was any more opportunities for you to have some more input. There's been a lot of opportunities. I would say that anything that is cut from this moment on will affect the children in programming in one way or another. We can go back and we can say no library books next year. That affects kids. That doesn't take away a home ec program. It doesn't take away a special ed teacher. But if we do that kind of thing, then we've got to do it again next year. So that no library books for 2 years. And that the only way that we can do the kind of things other than what we gave you a list of the things that we were considering would be to do away with things that we think make the school system work. And so the answer is any cut that we make from this moment on, to the best of my ability and to all of the opportunities we've had to go over this budget time and time again, the most recent time being this afternoon, the answer is no, we cannot cut this budget any further without affecting the quality of the education for the children.
Thank you, I appreciate it. So now, the feeling of the council, do they want to go through and into your municipal budget to reduce this? Anybody got any comment? Councilor LaTorre.
Chairman, I feel that it's only fair if we're going to make cuts that we participate on the municipal side as well as on the school side and not try to take the entire brunt from the school side. I can't, at this juncture, get into a debate or a discussion because I don't feel it's just appropriate to my position with Loretta or any of the school board members as to where cuts could or should be made. I do believe, however, I would have an open mind enough to say, I do believe there are some possibilities of cuts that have been alluded to this evening on the administrative side that would not cut into programs. But how you people would cut, a number we would give you, is strictly a covenant between you and the taxpayers and those that voted you in to make that decision. We can only just direct the most general areas because it is impossible from our position to peruse your budget as deeply as we have ours. And I think some of the possible cuts have been alluded to by some of the speakers and by the councilors on administrative side in terms of salaries or perhaps positions there. So it's with due respect that I would make these types of suggestions in terms of numbers of cuts. I guess Billy would call this the nitty-gritty. If we could participate on 20,000 on the town side, 53,494 on the school side to get us to a $73,494 cut, which brings us to a 9.9% tax increase, which to me is not an arbitrary number whatsoever. If I was going to associate any word with it, I would associate the word symbolic, very symbolic to me, of what we're trying to do in this town, to find that delicate balance that I alluded to earlier. The 20,000 on the municipal side, if painful as it is to me, because I'm one of the loudest exponents for acquiring some of the open space land in this town, because I believe that we have to be realistic in terms of if we want open space in the town, we're going to have to go out and buy it, not just wait for people to donate it to us. But cutting $10,000 from the land acquisition fund, and then possibly cutting $10,000 from Fund 320, 2012, which is refuse bailfill service, $10,000 there for the refuse bailfill service. We had a lot of $20,000 for demolition disposal. If we could cut that in half based on the fact that we're not sure when the Ross Grant plant is going to open for recycling, that we might not need all the equipment that we thought for recycling next year. That it may be a longer process, it may be into fiscal 91, that we might not need that whole $20,000 this year that we allotted for the move to recycling that's going to be happening. Again, it's hard to tell. It's hard to tell how many tons we're going to be taking to our RWS to say exactly what is our cost going to be there. There's some of these things that you do have to guesstimate. You can guesstimate on the conservative side, you can guesstimate on the liberal side. Perhaps that's a little bit on the liberal side. Perhaps we can find that $10,000 in there. And if worse comes to worse, if we have to take that from undesignated surplus later in the year, so be it. But at this juncture, I'd like to make a $20,000 contribution from the municipal side and the remainder $53,494. From the other side. I'm not going to make that into an official amendment. I'd just like to have a discussion from my fellow councilors on this as an opening discussion.
Thank you. Anybody else? Councilor McGaw.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Still tough. I concur with some of what Frank is saying. I do agree that the 9.9 is symbolic. One thing that is always in my mind is, what does this mean in real money? What does it mean to my pocketbook? And 9.9 is $1.42 on the tax rate. When I first looked at this budget, I was astounded, appalled, scared. We were looking at a $1.99 increase on the tax rate, and I said, we're not going to do that. And I don't think we are going to do that. We're not going to do the $1.99 that we started with when the council first began their budget deliberations. And I tried to figure out in my mind what I would be comfortable with, not looking at the percentages, but looking at the dollar amounts. We're not there yet at what I'm comfortable with. And I think we can work together with the school board. This is something that I hope everybody in this room has heard this evening, that we are a small town. This town is too small for divisiveness. Too small for bad feelings out of the budget. Your school board has worked really hard and diligently, and so has your council. Having rambled, Frank, I would be able to support cuts on the municipal side only if we ask the school department to make cuts on their side. If we get to that point, I agree with one of the cuts proposed by you very painfully, the land acquisition fund, $10,000. I know there's a counselor who would like to see us cut the entire $65,000.
That's right.
Yes, sir. I happen to believe that's another legacy we leave for our children, and I believe that very strongly. Our children and the children to follow in this town. Even if my children don't continue to live in Cape Elizabeth after they go through the high school or wherever they end up here. I think it's very important to leave that legacy for everybody else who has the opportunity to live in this town. I do not support a $10,000 cut in the regional, I'm going to call it the regional waste system part of our budget. The way I read our most recent memo from the manager, we need to be looking at more money, not less, if anything, for that budget because of proposed increases in the tipping fees from regional waste. So I can't support you there.
Thank you. Oh, you didn't want me to let, you didn't want me to answer. Go ahead, Councilor Emerald. I'll get to it.
Well, we do have a motion on the floor. I think that it's probably going to be fruitless to debate cuts or the amount of cuts before we know whether we're going to accept or not accept the motion that's on the floor, which is to vote on a budget with a 10.8% increase. So my suggestion would be that we vote on that, and if that passes, fine. If it doesn't, then we discuss the possibility of cuts.
I kind of disagree with that, but I think the council should have their chance to discuss what the motion is before we vote on it, and then we can vote either way we see fit, and then go back to the drawing boards if we have to. That's my opinion on it. I would just like to throw out my two cents here as far as I asked the chairman of the school board if they could cut any more without hurting the program, and she said no. So I don't see how we can say you go back and look anyway if they say they can't do it. Because I believe them, and that's what they've said. And as far as the regional waste fund, as Frank Latorre said earlier, let's go beyond this room. That regional waste system, that board feel they have a blank check out there with all these communities. And I think, I see Mary Webster earlier, I wish she'd still here, I'd buttonhole her afterwards. I think we gotta go somewhere, as in somebody put a brain check or a check on, because all of a sudden they feel they need a, before we budget it, they need another $10 a ton deal, just like that, because of some facilities that they're purchasing, and I think we should know in advance. And as far as the land deal, the way I look at it, I don't want to take away any land from my children or grandchildren or your children and grandchildren and great-grandchildren. But we have an account here with $100,000+ in it to purchase land. I say we don't have to put another $60,000-$65,000 into that. When we have money enough to buy an option, if some land comes available between now and the next budget year, that we feel that we should purchase for the future. This is why I've said for a long time that before I go for double-digit income increase, that I would propose that we take the whole business out, because we have enough to buy an option for a year. We just purchased something with Land Trust here. And they worked on that, I think, for Purdue years. So you don't go out and have to pay anybody tomorrow for a piece of land. You get an option on it, and you decide and get the research done on it. So I think it could be handled that way, and that was, my opinion, is a way to bring the budget down. So, anybody else got any comment? If not, I'll call for a vote on the motion. And I'll have a roll call vote. A clerk, please.
Chairman Jordan?
No.
No. Thank you.
One yes, six no.
Council Latorre.
In a further attempt to stimulate the conversation, being that the motion did fail and that a number has been bantered around a few times regarding bringing it under 10% or bringing it to 9.9, which is a $73,500 decrease, I would, and I have made a concrete proposal in terms of a ratio and some specific cuts, one of which on the municipal side I understand there is not a consensus building behind. I would appreciate if there were other, if I could get the feel of other councils, my fellow councils, in terms of A, what type of a ratio would they be looking for, and B, what other areas within the municipal side, which is really our jurisdiction tonight, all we'll be doing is handing, as we all know, the school board a number, which will be their very difficult decision to go back and make decisions there. But I'm curious as to what other possible cuts. One that we did mention, and again, this is not meaning any offense to any department head or anything. We went through this budget many, many, many times. There's been the suggestion of adding one maintenance worker or one park ranger under 641002. Without which I believe we would have savings of about $3,850. Yes, we are getting, I guess, to this level of cuts. If we combine that with the $10,000 from the land acquisition fund, and have a $13,000 on our side, a $60,000 on their side, I get the feeling that we're evolving towards some type of consensus, and I'd like to get a feeling, I'm not trying to rush anyone, but I do see a movement afoot here, and I'd like to get expressions from my other counselors.
Anybody else? Councilor Creamer.
I think that if we start opening up our red books and our green books tonight, it's going to be a long night. I'd like to get a consensus of my fellow councilors in the spirit of compromise, how people feel about splitting the 73.4. We take, we find out, we figure out half, and they figure out half. We get to 9.9. We're going to have to look at the land acquisition. I don't want to look at it. I think it's the family that comes to Cape Elizabeth and is, you know, here for a few years and gone that, that easily can give up on that one. I plan on being here, and I want that land for my kids. I'd just like to get a consensus in that department. And I know it's not equal. I mean, I know it's not equal in terms of the 30-70, but there's a feeling about that.
Councilor Amor.
I would propose that we recommend a cut, total cut of $73,500, 30% of that to be from the municipal side, which would be $22,000 some few odd dollars. The remainder to be from the school side of the budget, and that both the school and the town, if a motion should pass, which would put this into effect, if this happens, that both the town and the school board go back and make the cuts at some other point, but we not do it tonight because I don't think this is the proper forum to do that.
Thank you. There's only one thing. We've got to adopt this budget called its charter by the end of May,
right.
May 30th.
But we can adopt a figure and then figure out where the cuts will be made.
Thank you. Councilor Toth.
Is that a motion?
No, I didn't make a motion. I'm just putting up an idea.
Well, I think it's a good idea, Jay.
All right. I will make a motion that can we just have a couple minutes to put the figures into the motion?
Am I out of order? Am I out
of point of inquiry? This is really the council segment part of it and not the public. But while I'm getting the numbers together, I'll entertain one point of, very short.
What you're saying about the land acquisition is that if the town wants to buy a piece of land, they can affirmatively say yes, but have a whole year acquire the money to purchase it, so that there's no need to hold money in escrow as part of this year's tax base. Is that in essence what you're doing?
That is what I proposed, but it's a 6-to-1 type deal. There's already $100,000 into that account, and I say that is enough money to buy an option for a certain length of time. You might only need it for 6 months, you might only need it for 3 months, but it's something that you could use to go into the following year's budget if you want to purchase the land. Councilor Amor.
Yes, I have a motion ready now. Be it ordered that the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 14, 1990, upon the proposed fiscal year 1991 municipal budget, does hereby finally adopt a municipal budget for the town of Cape Elizabeth for the fiscal year 1991 with gross expenditures of $13,618,707 and gross resources of $4,585,487. The amount of $9,033,220 to be raised by taxation, and does further fix Wednesday, October 3rd, 1990, and Friday, May 3rd, 1991, as the dates upon each of which one half of such tax is due and payable, with interest to accrue upon taxes due and unpaid after each such date at the rate of 12% per annum. Okay. And the understanding is that the cuts reflected in that motion would be made at 30% from the municipal budget and 70% from the school budget.
Been moved and seconded. Anybody else got any comment? Councilor McLeod.
Another explanation of this motion is that this puts us at a 9.9% tax increase, $1.42 on the taxes. I'm not going to vote in favor of this motion. I think we're cutting too much.
Thank you. I want to know, understanding your motion, that when do you want the school board to come back at a next meeting? Are you going to adopt this budget as is with no other changes, and that's the way it is? They don't have no recourse. Is that what you're saying with your motion?
That's right. This would set the municipal budget. The school board would not come back to us, but they would have to meet and decide how to cut that remaining amount, which is about $50,000. And we would do the same thing. So we're setting a figure which would be set if we vote for it for a time.
Now, I just want these people, I'm just asking these questions, so these people that go home, I hope, might understand the process here, what's going to happen. If the school board comes back and cuts a program or two, and you get the swells of the ocean moving in, that isn't going to be our problem. Is that the way you put your motion? School board once, and they said they've been doing unless they cut programs, and I inclined to believe them, but I'll call for the motion and we'll have a roll call vote.
Chairman Jordan?
No.
Vice Chairman Jordan?
No.
Councilor Ambrose?
Yes.
Councilor Kotzoff?
Yes.
Councilor Krillman?
Yes.
Councilor Littori?
Yes.
Councilor Masterton?
Yes.
Councilor LeBlanc?
No.
But yes,
to them. You've heard it. You want to stay for the rest of the nitty gritty?
Yeah.
I give you a few minutes if you want to leave. We're going on to sewers. If anybody's interested in sewers, stand by, we're going to have a public hearing on the budget.
Thank you.
Okay.
Kindergarten, high school.
We have a public hearing as far as the sewer fund budget. Councilor Cargill.
Mr. Chairman, the fiscal year 1991 sewer fund budget has gross expenditures of $1,197,716 and gross revenues of $1,197,472. We're going to have a public hearing on that right now.
Thank you. Anybody from the public care to speak on our sewer budget concerns? If not, I'll close the second part of public hearing and move on to,
I guess a point of order, Mr. Chairman. I'm wondering if to satisfy state statutes, for whatever reason we have a number of articles with the first motion, if those need to be addressed somehow for the record. And I'm saying yes, they do. They've got to be read separately. Okay.
Are you redrafting them now?
Yeah.
You did think I was on the right track? Item 176, to consider the adoption of fiscal year 1991 sewer fund budget, take any necessary action. Councilor Cargill.
Shall I read the other articles first before we go on to the next number? Do you want me to dispense with Article B?
So moved.
Okay, now I'll just read Article A. This is the draft motion. Order the Cape Elizabeth Town Council accept the categories of funds listed below as provided by the Maine State Legislature. Category, State Subsidy for Education, $1,727,929.87. Adult Education, $45,413. Food Services, $18,000. Chapter 1, $22,000. Chapter 2, $11,000. Title 2, $2,000. The Drug Free Grant of $5,000. Local Entitlement of $42,000. Follow the Child, $2,600. Teacher Certification Grant, $13,500. Other Funds for Education, $50,000. Property Tax Relief, $34,629.13. Energy Conservation Grant of $38,205 for a grand total of $2,012,277.
You put that in the form of a motion. Do I hear a second?
Second.
Any other comments? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, 7-0.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that Articles B through G through H not be read, but are included as presented in our packet.
Second.
Any other comment? All in favor, raise your hand.
Mr. McGovern has a comment.
Yeah, I believe that should be with reduction of 51,455.
The article that you just gave is 2,120. Those are your figures he's asking about.
Article D, 1,893,175. Yeah, it's all, what I've done is made reductions in the draft that the council has here, 51,455, and the numbers that would affect. Okay, it affects Article D, Article E, and Article B.
All set? Any other comments?
I just want to clarify for the public who may not have this information. that one of these articles, Article G, is for a repair and replacement bond. This is to bond in the amount not to exceed $422,500 for repairs, basically to roofs in the for the schools and some replacement of equipment at the high school.
Any other comment? If you've got the motion. Would you care to read the motion back?
The motion for the sewer budget draft.
10-4.
Ordered, be it ordered, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 14, 1990, does hereby adopt the fiscal year 1991 sewer fund budget with gross expenditures of $1,197,716 and gross revenues of $1,197,472. Is there a second?
Second.
Just a moment. That isn't the one that we voted on. That one, that isn't one the change that you made in B, D, is the one that we needed. And I believe there was a motion made and seconded, but we never voted on it. Come to my lady on the right.
We waived the reading.
Okay, everybody understand it? All in favor, raise your hand. All opposed to it? Reading what the budget was approved. Is that correct? That's what we are. They say we did. So you want to? We'll clarify the motion.
Mr. Chairman.
Just a minute.
Which motion would you like me to read now?
The sewer fund.
You want me to read that one again?
Yeah.
Yes. Read it.
We're on the sewer budget, is that correct?
Yes.
For the third time, ordered the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 14, 1990, has hereby adopted the fiscal year 1991 sewer fund budget with gross expenditures of $1,197,716 and gross revenues of $1,197,472.
Second.
And moved and seconded. Any other questions? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? So vote. 7-0.
Just for the record, there seems to be some confusion on whether or not A, B, C, D, E, F, and G, and H were approved with the necessary amendment of reducing $51,455 in H. Perhaps for Deb's records, if someone, if that is the intent of the council, if someone would move that and second it, it might be voted on, it might help.
Second.
Any other comment? I think we did, but that's all right. All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? So vote. Double vote, sewer fund. Item 177, to consider the, to consider the adoption of fiscal year 1991 Riverside budget and take any necessary action. I'll now open this up to a public hearing as far as the Riverside Cemetery budget. Anybody got any comment? Those people don't raise any right. Does any, Councilor Coggeshall, would you like to make a motion?
Mr. Chairman, be it ordered the Cape Elizabeth Town Council, having held a public hearing on May 14, 1990, does hereby adopt the fiscal year 1991 Riverside Cemetery Trust Fund budget with gross expenditures of $11,830 and gross revenues of $32,530.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. Any other comments? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? Oh, 7-0. Item 178, to consider authorizing financing $422,500 for the school facilities improvements and take any necessary action. Councilor Coggeshall.
Mr. Chairman, we are proposing that we borrow for the school a total of $422,500 to repair primarily roofs in the middle school, high school wing, and exterior door replacements and high school phone system in the high school.
I'll open it up to the public. I have to have a public hearing on this item also. Anybody got a comment? Mr. Capano, glad to see you here.
Step right up
to the mic. You'll miss your voice if you don't.
I'm Edmund Capano. I live on Spillwood Avenue in Cape Elizabeth. I'm a little bit curious about the financing of this particular item. I'm not against doing it. However, we just went through quite an ordeal with the school budget, and now we are increasing the school budget in a sense again by extending over a period of years the payment for this particular project. Why can't this be included, or why couldn't it have been included in the budget?
It could have been included in the budget, but the reason it was done, the main reason was the majority of it is for roofs repair, and they figure that it can be amortized over a period of years, and that was a good way as far to bond it.
But at the same time, it's not credited to the school. Is it? This is strictly the town doing the work?
No. The school department will get contracts and come in to do the work.
And this is above and beyond the budget.
That's correct.
Interesting.
Anybody else got a comment? Therefore, I'll close public segment and we'll move on to the item.
Mr. Chairman, just for a little bit of background, this is the last in a series of long neglected roof repairs, and we have to applaud the school board for finally making the hard decision of doing it. It's been neglected for many, many years. And last year we borrowed $600,000 for this type of repair. So all the acres of roofs will be healthy for a long period of time. We have before us an authorization for borrowing for the schools. I'm willing to read the first paragraph if the fellow members of the council would vote that I not read the other eight.
Go ahead. Second. All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote.
Okay, pursuant to the provisions of Section 5772 of Title 30A of the Maine Revised Statutes and all other authority thereto, enabling and in order to provide funds for repair, alterations, and equipment for the town schools, including roof repairs and equipment for the town's elementary, middle, and high schools, the Town Council of Cape Elizabeth hereby authorizes the issue, sale, and delivery of not in excess of $422,500 aggregate principal amount of general obligation notes or bonds of the town. Such notes or bonds to be designated Town of Cape Elizabeth, Maine, 1990 school note or bond, and to have a maturity not to exceed 10 years. The document also goes on to authorize the treasurer and chairman of the town council to borrow the money.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman.
Councilor Torrey.
I'd like to just ask the manager to clarify for Mr. Capano the question that he raised. This is not going to, if the passage of this does not increase the tax rate any further, because this is, I understand, it is already incorporated in terms of payments for this, they're already incorporated in the budget. It's already incorporated. It's not, I thought you were left with a misconception.
It was rather awkwardly I presented it.
Yeah, it's not going to raise the taxes anymore. It's still a debt.
I just wanted it to be incorporated rather than something separate.
It is.
Mr. Chairman? Is this over $400,000 a note or a bond? Or could it be either? It was my impression it was going to be a note.
It says a note or a bond. It could be either.
It's going to be a note.
What will happen will be a note, not a bond.
It says a note or a bond.
No, Janet. So we've been moved and seconded. And we shall vote on 178 to consider authorizing financing of $422,500 for the school facilities improvements and take any necessary action. Any other comment? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? It's a vote, 7-0. Item 179, consider authorizing the borrowing of $115,000 for the construction of a wood frame addition to the Cape Elizabeth Middle School and take any necessary action. Councilor Cogshaw, you have a comment before I open it up to public hearing? Okay. This, I think everybody's heard about the portable classrooms and what have you, so I don't think I need to go any except to introductions, so I'll open it up to the public, and is there anybody out there that has a comment? Yes, lady in back.
My name is Teresa Camelot, and I teach at Palm Coast School in special ed classroom.
Is that my phone?
Yes.
I hear myself. I'm a special ed teacher, K-3 at Palm Cove, and I come forward at this point, and not earlier, in support of the kids that I've been teaching for 5 years. I initially piloted the program for multiply involved kids at Palm Cove, and currently still have basically that same population of children working diligently at mainstreaming them, but at this point, the core of their curriculum comes from program that I provide for them. And my concern, the reason why I'm coming forth, is without this portable, the children who I've had for 5 years will maintain at Palm Cove. They're not going to get the opportunity to graduate over. And I can't stress to you strongly enough how important that is to them. For 5 years being in one classroom, one school, they've been waiting for this opportunity to move over, and I think it would be really detrimental and I think really affect their sense of self-esteem to have to be held back. So as sort of a personal feel, I would hope that the portable does pass in lieu of the children that are prepared to move over, because this indeed is looked at as graduation step for them. And I'm prepared to take them over and to continue the kind of program that they're getting now.
Thank you. Anybody else? Mrs. Capella.
I would like to feel that this is the last portable classroom we're going to build in Cape Elizabeth. I would suggest that if the projection in the future is an increase in children in our school system, that we would seriously consider construction of a permanent type building. It is unfair for these young children, even though the temporary classrooms are well constructed, but it's still unfair for them to have to worry about where they are going to go. After all, this evening we had a lot of people concerned about the children in our schools, and that's right. And I have been concerned with them myself for a period of years. So it would behoove, I think, the school board and the superintendent of schools and whoever else is interested in looking into the creation or the construction of an additional building that would be permanent. I would like to make one more comment. The first classroom construction between Pond Cove and Lent School, I did not like, principally because years ago that space was kept in case we needed more classrooms. And those two buildings were going to be joined to make it one complex. I would have much preferred to see that we constructed that building, added perhaps 4 or 5 classrooms, plus what was included at the time that was set aside for a utility room, or what we would, I would call a gym. So it behooves, I think, us, each one of us, taxpayers and those in authority, to consider construction of a permanent building, if the case is needed. To continue to put one room here or two rooms and so forth begins to cover areas that tend to become, I guess, a hodgepodge. And I would like to think that we are in a proper frame of mind for all of the children in our system, that they get not only the best possible education, but also the best house to house them. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else? Therefore, I close the public segment of the item and move on to item 179, to consider authorizing the borrow $115,000 for the construction of a wood frame addition to the Capitalist Miss School and take any necessary action. Council Coggeshall, you care to make a motion?
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a similar motion as I proposed before, that I read two sections of this document from the Bond Council and have us vote on the whole document.
Second.
Everybody understand? Okay. Voted pursuant to the provisions of Section 5772 of Title 30A of the Maine Revised Statutes and all other authority thereto enabling, and in order to provide funds for acquisition and construction of portable classrooms for town schools and costs and expenses related thereto, including without limitation, planning, design, engineering costs, the Town Council of Cape Elizabeth, the Town of Cape Elizabeth, hereby authorizes the issue, sale, and delivery of not in excess of $115,000 aggregate principal amount of the general obligation notes or bonds of the town. Such notes or bonds to be designated Town of Cape Elizabeth, Maine, 1990, portable classroom note, parentheses, or bond, into parentheses, and to have a maturity not in excess of 5 years. And on the second page, the voted that the town covenants and certifies that no part of the proceeds of this issue and sale of the notes or bonds authorized to be issued by the foregoing resolutions, parentheses, including any notes, bonds, and renewal thereof, parentheses, shall be used directly or indirectly to acquire any securities or obligations, the acquisition of which would cause such notes or bonds to be arbitrage bonds within the meaning of Section 148 of the International Internal Revenue Code of 1986, as amended, the code.
Second. Moved and seconded. Any other comment? Council Latour. Maybe we could get the school in a rail system here. We're not good at that.
You're a better MC than Ed McMahon. You're doing very well tonight. But I just wanted to say, I guess, that I have great difficulty in voting for this, though I will, because it kind of goes back to what some of the speakers were saying tonight, that we can't always get exactly all the things that we want within the school system. We love our kids so much and we'd like to be able to. And this, to me, I think, is just a perfect example of, yes, alternatives 2, 3, and 4, as I'm looking at them, may be a little bit more unsavory and have some scheduling problems, et cetera. And so we don't want to have to deal with that right now. We'll go with the portable classroom. But I just feel that somehow, if you all had gotten together to really brainstorm over, we could have found a way around this one. I feel that I'm in a position where I almost have to vote for this, because you're telling me that if I don't, there's going to be further cuts of programs and further dramatic cutting to the bone. So I feel almost that I'm cornered into voting for it, but I'm unhappily doing so.
Mr. Chairman, I want to make sure I have clear in my mind what kind of situation we're looking at if we vote in favor of the portable classrooms. My understanding is that at this point, the school department is saying it needs 3 additional classrooms for the coming year. The portable being requested will provide 4 additional classrooms. Aretas keeps shaking my head. One projection at this point is that 2 more classrooms will be most likely needed a year from now. If I vote for a portable classroom for fiscal year 91, I'll go along with what Ed Capano has said a few minutes ago. I don't expect to be voting for any more portable classrooms. I'm told, I've been reassured on a number of occasions, that once this bulge of students that we see at middle school is ready to be in the high school building, the space in the high school can adequately house them. Shake your head. That's an assumption that I am going on right now. I think this may be the time to put forward some suggestions that have been made by other boards in this town. School board has heard and the council has heard the concerns of the planning board and the zoning board of appeals about long-range space planning for the school system. In April 1988, there was a report issued called Master Plan for School Facilities. I've been looking at that, and I haven't seen much results following up on that report. If they're happening, I'm going to be better educated about that and made aware of it. I think one thing that I would like the council and the school board to consider is a cooperative effort and allow I'm loath to put forth another committee recommendation that there be a jointly appointed committee to look at the comprehensive school facilities, long-range planning for school space needs. And that is something that, if I can get some positive feedback between now and within the next couple of weeks from the school board and my fellow counselors, that I will ask to be formally on the June agenda for the council. Thank you.
Anybody else got a comment? You all set down there? All set. Seeing this issue has been kind of a controversial type issue, I will have a roll call vote on this one. Clerk, please call the roll.
Chairman Jordan?
Yes.
Councilor Ambrose? Masterton?
Yes.
Council LeBlanc?
Yes.
Very good. Thank you. Now you can all go home and relax.
I'm in your way.
Item 180, to consider the adoption of amendments of the subdivision ordinance. Did I miss something? Subdivision ordinance related to inspection fees and securities and requirements for approved subdivisions, site plans, and taking necessary action. Council Creighton, will you? I wanted you to make a few comments and then we'll have a public hearing so people would understand what's going on. What we have here before I open it up to public hearing is to change the construction permit. When a subdivision comes in with a subdivider and he asks for a permit, he's gonna, instead of 2%, it's gonna be raised to 3%, the cost of the required improvements payable to us with a certified check to town of Kegelsman. For any other requirements, remaining improvements which are not completed within 3 years of the date of final approval, an additional inspection fee of 1/12 of 1% per month of the value of the remaining improvements shall be made for the each additional month covered by the approved bond or revocable letter of credit. This fee shall be paid upon approval of a new or extended bond or a letter of credit. No portion shall be refunded should the work be completed prior to the end of the period covered by the bond or the revocable credit, letter of credit, excuse me. This inspection fee and surety requirement shall also be applied to the site plan improvements required by the planning board under section 19-2-9, provided the required site improvement exceeds 10,000 in estimated costs. These are the one of the changes, and then there's another change down here. I guess I would have to. So the subdividers shall notify the town manager in writing the time when the proposed to commence the construction, such improvements so that the town can cause inspections and so that, I guess they didn't have those two words in there before, requirements shall be met during the construction to assume satisfactory completion of all improvements and utilities required by the planning board. So I'll open that up to a public hearing if anybody's left here would like to comment on the changes. Nobody has any comment. Therefore, I'll close the public hearing and move on to item 180. To consider the an amendment to the subdivision ordinance related to the inspection fees and securities and requirements for the approved subdivision and site plan and take any necessary action. And can I make a motion? Council McGraw.
Keep us quiet, definitely. Mr. Chairman, I would like to move that we adopt the amendment to the subdivision ordinance as previously read.
Anybody else got a comment? All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, leave it to 7-0.
Mr. Chairman.
Council asks.
No, it's me.
Council. Oh, sorry.
Rocket. I move that we waive the rule for the 11 o'clock new business.
Oh, I didn't realize it was that way. Been moved to attend that we waive the rule of 11 o'clock, which is one of the requirements of council rules that in taking up items after 11 o'clock. All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, so vote 7-0. If you want to finish the agenda, I don't know what you're doing. Item 181, to consider adopting new permit fees and take any necessary action. Would the manager care to make a comment on the permit fees? You have had a very easy evening. Mike, it's yours.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. It's proposed to increase the number of the building permit fees that have not been increased since January 1 of 1983. Currently, with building permits, the minimum fee is $5, but then $4 per 1,000. It's proposed to raise that to a minimum fee of $10 plus $5 per 1,000, a fairly substantial increase percentage-wise. The electrical permits would also go up from a minimum fee of $5 to $10, and similar fees on the schedule that you can see that Jerry Dagle attached. The plumbing permit set by the state is currently $6. The minimum would be $10 with no other changes being made to the state plumbing fee schedule. Heating permit fees are also proposed to be adjusted with a minimum fee of $10. And the council has before you the list as recommended by the code enforcement administrator.
Thank you. Anybody else have any comment? Council Masterson.
I'm sorry that Mr. Dagle has left, because these raises are, in some cases, quite dramatic, let me put it that way. And supposedly, the increases are to cover the cost of the work of granting a permit. And does the manager know if these new fees do accurately reflect costs?
I can't say that they do one for one, but I will say that this is, for the most part, a 25% increase across the board, although there were some slight variations in there. I can easily say that our costs since 1983, in terms of salaries, benefits, and the other services that we utilize for providing these services, have in fact increased more than 25%.
Thank you. I'll open it up to the public. This requires a public hearing. Does anybody else have a comment one way or the other?
When does it go into effect?
30 days after a vote tonight.
Oh, I think the manager is proposing June 1st that they go into effect. Any other comment?
I want to get my comment.
Why not 30 days as everything else does?
Ordinance amendments are in fact 30 days. I'm suggesting June 1st so we can get a little bit of revenue between June 1st and June 14th.
Can we have a motion?
No.
No, we haven't had a motion. Just a minute. I'm just saying. No, anybody else in the public? Therefore, I'll close the public segment of the item and move on and ask for a motion. Councilor Masterson, you want the mic? The move and second that we adopt the permit fee changes that has been proposed by our assessor. Anybody else got a comment? Councilor Greenman.
This will be effective as of what day, Mr. Chairman?
June 1st.
June 1st.
The minutes will so state. Okay, anybody else? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? So vote. Sound enough. Item 182. To consider adopting a review escrow fee and take any necessary action. And what this is, would you like to comment on it?
A review escrow fee is a fee paid for a developer when they apply to the planning board to have certain facets of the proposal looked at. Specifically, the areas suggested here are wetland evaluations, traffic studies, stormwater evaluation, forestry studies, wildlife studies, sewer capacity evaluation, soil suitability. The fee is proposed to be $250 per lot, as shown on a preliminary plan in major subdivisions. In major subdivisions and in multiplex units in major subdivisions, $100 per unit. For minor subdivisions, there would not be a review escrow fee under this proposal.
Thank you. Is anybody from the public out there care to comment on item 182?
Is it partially refunded if the or does the town keep all of it?
The fee is refunded, I believe, within so many days. There's a provision for it under the next item. Within 90 days of it having been completed, it would be refunded any balance.
Does it cost us any money? Will it cost the town any money?
The plan on this is to try to recover expense. Right now it is costing us money. We're trying to have it so it breaks even.
Anybody else? Therefore, I'll close the public part and move on to 182. I have a comment before I move on, I might say, which I don't quite understand the difference between this item and the next item, because it seems though they pretty much almost say the same thing, but the other one may be in more detail. The part that I don't understand is the fee may also be utilized for expenses incurred by the town to defend an approval of a subdivision should an appeal be filed in the Maine Superior Court. It seems so that the fee shall be waived for any lots or units to be developed conforming with the affordable housing provision that may be enacted by the town of Gainesville. Now, I mentioned this once before, and I am still don't understand. Once the town approves something from a developer, therefore, why isn't the town, why do you still keep the subdivider's money, as I understand this, to defend something that somebody might appeal it after you approve it? And I don't think it's right, I'm against it. Does anybody want to comment? Well, I'm all alone, okay. Move on to the motion. Anyone care to make a motion? Item 182.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that we adopt the proposed review escrow fee as thus stated.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? 6-1. Item 183, to consider adopting an amendment to the subdivision ordinance relating to the procedures for the administration to review escrow fees and take any necessary action. Councilor Masterson. That is correct. Okay. You want to?
This is, Chairman Joy indicated, is closely related to the last issue. This is actually the enabling legislation in the ordinance that provides for the review escrow fee. Currently, it has been authorized that there could be a review escrow fee for about 3 or 4 years, but never officially set up. What this particular amendment does, it clarifies that the services are actually procured by the town manager upon advice of the planning board, not directly by the planning board, keeping with the manager's position as the purchasing agent for the town. Furthermore, it eliminates a series of provisions in this section that provides that every so that once the balance gets down to 25% of its original level, that we could ask for it again and again and again every time it gets down to 25%. What this does, it essentially stops that and it caps it at the items and at the amounts that were indicated in the earlier motion. Finally, it does provide for the refunding. now, within 90 days after final decision of the subdivision application. 90 days was chosen because sometimes the bills take a while to get in to ensure that the bills are owed. Thank you.
Anybody from the public? We'll close the public part on this item and move on if anyone cares to make a motion. Councilor Masters.
I move that we adopt this amendment to the subdivision ordinance related to the decision to the construction of the
Been moved in second. Anybody else got a comment? If not, I'll call a vote. They still have this added to the bottom of it that I am opposed to. Unless there's legal action pending on town approval of a subdivision. And I still say, once you approve it, it's yours. And you shouldn't use somebody else's money to defend it. All those in favor of the motion, please raise your hand. Those opposed. Six to one. Now, we have a couple of residents out here. I've been waiting patiently, and it's 11:15. Item 184 to consider vacating an unaccepted portion of Manaway Street and take any necessary action. I believe you all received a memo in your packet, and I don't know if you have any comments, but what I'll do is requires a public hearing, so I'll open it up to the public. Is anybody out there care to make a comment? Nobody wants to make a comment? Henrietta, do you want to make a comment? I wanted to break it up a little bit, that was the idea. So, I'll close the public hearing. Does anybody care to make a motion? Want the mic? Go ahead, Council Masters. Moved and second. Anybody else got a comment? All those in favor of the motion, raise your hand.
I just want to make sure that.
Oh, I didn't see your hand. I'm sorry.
That the motion would reflect the actual order that
we have. That would be correct. All right. All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, it's a vote. 7-0. It's all yours. Hang on, sorry.
They should get a plaque for waiting.
She got a dooyah back. Item 185, to consider authorizing 1990-1991 tax anticipation notes borrowing and taking necessary action. Councilor Cogswell.
Mr. Chairman, do I read the whole order now? Voted pursuant to Section 5771 of Title 31-A of the Maine Revised Statutes, the Town Treasurer is hereby authorized and empowered to borrow money from time to time during the fiscal year ending June 30, 1991, in an amount or amounts not exceeding $1,500,000 at any time outstanding, in anticipation of the collections or receipts from taxes by the issuance of negotiable tax anticipation notes of the Town. Each of which notes shall be designated tax anticipation notes of the fiscal year 1990-1991. All of such tax anticipation notes and any extensions, renewals, or replacements thereof shall be signed by the town treasurer, countersigned by the chairman of the town council, and attested by the town clerk, shall be payable on or before June 30, 1991. Out of money raised by taxation, may be issued in non-interest-bearing form and sold on a discount basis or issued at par and bear interest payable at maturity, and be discounted or bear interest payable at maturity at such rate or rates as may be approved by the treasurer and the chairman of the town council by their execution thereof. Voted, all said tax anticipation notes are hereby designated as qualified tax exempt obligations within the meaning of section 265 parens B parens of the Internal Revenue Code of 1986 and in furtherance of such designation. The treasurer shall be and hereby is authorized to covenant on behalf of and in the name of the town of Cape Elizabeth that the town will not issue in excess of 10 million aggregate principal amount of tax exempt obligations during calendar year 1990.
Thank you. Been
moved. Could you repeat that, Mr. Chairman? I didn't quite get all that.
Well, I've been talking to Nancy, but you've got it, but I'll have a clerk read it back.
Thank you. I'll read it later.
Thank you. All those in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed, vote 7-9. Item 186, to consider authorizing a quitclaim deed for our map U32 lot 6-39 on Kildare Road and take any necessary action. I believe the manager would like that.
Yeah, this is a standard quitclaim deed for I think it's Robert and Verna Finlay for land situated, as the item indicates, on Kildare Road. There is no outstanding indebtedness covered by the period.
Councilor Latour.
Mr. Chairman, I would ask that we authorize a quick claim deed for map U32, lot 6-39 on Kildare Road.
And moved and seconded. Any other comment? All in favor, raise your hand. Those opposed? So moved. 7-9. Citizens' discussion. Item is not on the agenda. Anybody out there have a comment they'd like to make? One way or the other, up here and there. Come. Oh, Mr. Kapow. This is for you.
Just two quick.
Step right up here so we can see you. The camera wants to see you. Your wife wants to know you.
Yeah, that's true. One, where might I get a more detailed budget? We used to get a little bit more elaborate budget in the past. I'd like to.
How many did you take care of?
Okay. And the second one is what's the town's indebtedness now? Roughly speaking. We're safe, right?
Well, we're safe. Yeah. We're not bad too. No. Mostly the sewers in the library, I think.
All the schools are paid for?
All the main buildings are paid for, just the portables.
Well, the portables are paid anyway.
Yeah.
Sense by the state. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
Anybody else? Do I hear the big motion? Did you have something, Councilor Crowley?
I just wanted to ask if when we were going to need to sign our budget cuts.
I didn't know we might kind of get our heads together here after the Monday night. He'll send out an addendum to the agenda for the 21st and we'll take care of that. That is correct. Yes, sir. Councilor Tony. You need the mic?
I just wanted to say that your plan worked. By keeping my mic dead to my right, we saved an hour.
Good move, Billy.
You gotta be thinking ahead, gentlemen. So we have a meeting, you know, the 21st, and we'll be ready for your swan song at that time, and you only have 5 minutes.
Give me 6.
Do I have a motion, Jim? All favor, Jim. Those opposed? Good night. Thank you all for coming. Thank you for staying.